that's on.
Probably one of the things.
And
better.
I'm thinking when you guys are answering questions,
I think we actually have more
people. You might want to just leave it on while you're answering questions and pass it around. It might be easiest. But it's going to start. I don't think you...
Thank you. 6. We're going to start the official portion of this program in about 3 minutes. So if you haven't gotten your coffee yet, feel free to grab that right now. But we will start up in about 3 minutes. Good morning. Welcome. Thank you all for being here this morning. I know that for some of you it was a little difficult to make it here. Thank you to you folks who are online for joining us that way as well. And because of the morning, I do expect that people will be trickling in, which we totally understand. Again, thanks to all of you for however you made it here. It is exciting to see you here. I'm Susan McKinnell. I have to look at my notes to see that. I'm in user experience support here at the University of Minnesota, and I'm also just one of the executive committee members. There are several of us here. You can recognize us by our name tags, so do feel free to say hi if you want more information about this group. WIT, Women in Technology, has been around since the spring of last year, and we are a community for women to share experiences and resources about working in technology in a supportive network. We are open to membership from anyone. So first of all, I want to thank everyone in this room, no matter who you are, and want to encourage you to join and help support our mission. You can join by going to the WIT website, which is wit.umn.edu, and I'll repeat that at the end of this event as well. And all that really means is hopping onto the mailing list so you can hear about the events that come up and being supportive in that way. So one thank you I want to give out, and that is that WIT was a recent recipient of a Campus Climate Microgrant. So thank you to the Campus Climate folks for supporting what we're doing. They're helping make events like this possible and supporting our 2017 programming. So with that, I would like to introduce the gentlemen who are on the stage with me today. First of all, I'd like to introduce our panel moderator, Richard Matson-Daly. Richard is an IT liaison at the in the Office of Information Technology at the University of Minnesota, and he's spent the better part of a decade helping nonprofit organizations engage activists, mobilize volunteers, and energize donors through technology. Since 2014, he has been working at the University of Minnesota as an IT liaison, where he helps faculty and staff connect to the technology resources they need to establish their work of changing lives and addressing the grand challenges of our world through teaching, research, and outreach. And then on my immediate left is Steve Anderson. Steve is the Senior Director of Integrated Media and Creative Resources at the University of Minnesota Foundation. Steve and his teammates are responsible for creating and maintaining digital properties for a diverse set of audiences, with close colleagues that include front-end programmers, UX specialists, content strategists, designers, multimedia producers, and content marketing experts. The Foundation's Integrated Media and Creative Resources team operates as a full-service digital agency serving internal clients with a fundraising and stewardship focus. Immediately to his left is Kamal Badur. Kamal is the Senior Director of Infrastructure and Production at the Office of Information Technology here at the University of Minnesota. Kamal provides strategic direction for the university's infrastructure, including networking, server and storage administration, data center operations, and databases. And Kamal has held various roles at the University of Minnesota since 1998, including teaching, research, IT infrastructure, and technology-enhanced learning. Prior to his career at the university, he worked as an analyst and researcher at several financial institutions in Turkey. He holds a Master's of Arts in Economics from the University of Minnesota. And to Kamal's left is Diego Romalo. Diego is a senior business process consultant at Medtronic. Diego leads the ICE Improvement Center of Excellence team within customer care at Medtronic. And he was born and raised in Spain, and he made the Twin Cities his home in 1994. He started his IT career as a business analyst at Carl's & Companies, and in the 20 plus years that followed, Diego has held roles of increasing responsibility in both technical and leadership roles spanning the entire development lifecycle. And then on Diego's left is Brett Barney. And Brett is an associate professor of biosystems and bioproducts engineering at CFANS and CSE here at the University of Minnesota. Brett is also a member of the Biotechnology Institute at the University of Minnesota. His laboratory studies routes to the biosynthetic production of high-value products and biofuels by bacteria and algae, and the production of biofertilizers, which could be substituted for conventional fertilizers, produced by industrial processes. So, with that, I want to thank you all very much for being here with us today, and I'm going to hand things over to Richard to start the conversation.
All right. Thank you very much, Susan. Let's give our panelists a round of applause, first of all. Preemptive. You know, we have this idea within the world of technology of a meritocracy. It's sort of an ideal we hold that two people in a garage, if they have the talent and if they do the work, they produce a great product, that it will rise to the top, that they will be rewarded for the work that they put in and the talent that they have. But when we look around the rooms of our industries, when we look around our programming rooms, our engineering rooms, we find that that ideal doesn't seem to work out in practice. We find that we don't seem to be rewarding all the talent and the work of all groups equally. And specifically in this case, we find that there are way fewer women in the room than there should be. And this is a problem. For two reasons, really. The first is that it's a moral problem. If we believe in this sort of meritocracy, if we believe that the talent wins out, if the work, the quality of the work should speak up loudly, then what we have is a moral problem. We aren't backing up what we believe with our actions. We also have a technology and a business problem. We have a problem in which we, as the people who lead technology and the people who are trying to make great products for the world and trying to help accomplish big missions using technology, we aren't getting the best talent because for some reason, we are taking half of the population and saying, this half is going to be rewarded more. This half is going to be less. We're going to utilize the talent of one particular half of the population more, and we're going to utilize a half of the population less. And so because of this, this is not just a feminist problem, this is not just a woman problem, but this is a problem for all of us who are within within the worlds of technology. And so the goal of our event this morning is to talk about that, to talk about how men in particular can help and can contribute to solving this problem that is often seen as just a woman's problem, and also to give some concrete steps to see how we can be a part of the solution, not necessarily in a way where we're suddenly deciding, hey, here's what women need to do to make this better, but really to listen and to hear the experiences that we don't have and figure out how we can make things better. So that's all I'm going to say, and the rest of this conversation is going to be questions that we'll be asking our panelists. And so I'm just gonna jump in with maybe an easy one. We'll see. So the first thing is, you know, there are people who will disagree with everything I just said. There are folks who say gender diversity is not a problem in the industry, whether it's computers, whether it's engineering, the technology industry. What do you think about that? Based on your experience and your knowledge of the industry, is gender diversity a problem? How has that problem shown up in your spaces? And we have a microphone on the table y'all can use. Whoever wants to jump in first.
We are on now? Yes. So first I wanted to thank Women in Technology for setting up this event. It's certainly an important topic. I wanted to touch on one point before. You're talking about a moral problem, and that I think it makes an assumption that there's necessarily, it starts talking about what the root cause may be of this one. I think it's a problem of opportunity, not so much a moral problem. I think that diversity, there's certainly a gap, and it's unquestionable. If you walk into a technology group, you're going to see a majority of men, even white male, within a certain age range, you're going to see. I think that what is missed is an opportunity of actually having more diverse opinions, points of views, and experiences that would only enrich the outcome of any group.
Thank you. Great.
So I'll make a very basic point. I checked out so I have 93 people in my organization. I checked my statistics this morning. It's 13% women. If I was tossing a coin and it came up heads only 13% of the time, I would not say, that's okay, that's just to be expected. Mm-hmm. And I think really with the law of large numbers, that's really the problem we have. Pretend that it's not a problem because of there are reasons for this, doesn't mean that we are doing the right thing. And I fully agree with you that we're ignoring a very substantial part of our pool. And to me, that makes it also a business problem. Because in a place like this, we have hard time attracting talent, retaining talent, and saying that we're gonna ignore this problem, not do anything about it, and pretend it's okay is something that's also practically and rationally a problem, even if we feel that it's not something that we need to deal with.
So I didn't want to go first because if I just look at the data set of our little team of 18, I think we're fairly balanced. We've got 10 women and 8 men on our team, 4 women in positions of management and 3 men. That's not to say that we're doing something extremely well or better than others. I think I need to point out that we straddle that line between marketing and technology. Technology is a tool that we use, you know, every day, but we're not sort of, we wouldn't be considered a core technology business necessarily. So I just wanted to make that point. But also I can say that, you know, the data doesn't tell the whole story. This, being a panelist here has enabled me to open up a dialogue. I sat down with the women leaders on my team, and that, you know, it enabled me to sort of get below the surface of this particular topic and hear what they're thinking and hear what they're observing in a way that, just because we're balanced from a gender perspective, doesn't necessarily reveal. So I'll say, you know, conversation is important too.
Actually, could you dig into that a little bit? So you actually had the conversation. What were you, what did you hear? What were some of the things that the women in your group said to you?
It's not on the list. No. you know, it didn't reveal a lot of problems in the way that our team is just doing things, thankfully. But, you know, we reached way back. We have folks who've been in the workforce for, you know, 10 or more years in most cases. And so they've had a lot of experiences. Some of them are coming from the corporate world where things may have been a little bit different, and they had more sort of the traditional, you know, unfortunate instances and stories to share. I will say one of the themes that emerged for me, even though I set this up within the context of, you know, gender diversity and male allies and that sort of thing, they did recognize that some of the things that were making them uncomfortable were also coming from women. So I thought that was an interesting point. And it made us wonder as a group, sort of, is there a particular license, you know, depending on what gender you are and which gender you are communicating with, where you might not be quite as cognizant of the messages that you're sending and the effect that they may be having? Is that specific enough?
That works.
And Brett, what do you think? How do you experience gender diversity? Is that a problem in your spaces?
So I would say, you know, I've experienced a number of different places that I've been through. I'm now in a predominantly engineering department, and this is probably the poorest I've seen. We are only 3 female faculty out of 39, I think I counted last night when I looked at ours, so very, very low. I would say, having been in a chemistry department at one point, when I first started there, our numbers were pretty close, I would say. A bigger department, but and a few more women, but percentage-wise was probably pretty sad. I would say in the 4 years I was in graduate school, there was, and I don't know if it was something that was being done by the administration, but when I left, there were a lot more, and very big name, strong female figures that were very good role models to have in the department. So I did see that change. It shifts if you move a little bit more towards biology for some reason, and our department's a biologically engineering type department. And so if you look at our students coming through, our student body's very evenly balanced. Mm-hmm. And so there is a shift. I'm not 100% certain why that is. I have my own ideas. I think that we scare a lot of people in general. I think we scare a lot of young students out of math very early in this country. And for some reason, we do a much better job at scaring women out of math early on. And that's really going to hurt you if you're trying to get people into engineering. So we're very cognizant of it. We've recognized that we have an issue in our department. And I'd like to say that we can take major steps to do things. But if you look at our applicant pools, the applicant pool is kind of mirroring what we have in the department. When you do have some female applicants that are out there, they are being sought after by everybody, because every department has the same issue in the engineering departments where you're trying to bring those in. So some good news is that you can see there is a generation coming up that will be more balanced. But it's kind of sad to think it's going to be potentially 10 years before we really have people move through the tenure process and get into that and get established before you really see that change.
I want to follow up. I love hearing that, but I want to caution a little bit. One of the biggest things, biggest problems that I see in technology right now is not that we are not getting women into the workforce, but they are leaving. Mm-hmm. You look at numbers, the number of the female participation in IT is actually going down. So they are getting degrees, they are getting into the field, but then they are leaving. And there is a lot of, I mean, a lot of stuff we can talk about, but just getting, I mean, we've been a female majority in college campuses for a long time now. More women are getting college degrees than men, that's been going on for a long time, but that hasn't really reached the workforce in the way that it should have. We're losing a lot of junior people who, for a variety of reasons, leave. And that's, I think, something that we really should be careful about. I mean, again, I've been very hopeful for a long time, but it hasn't panned out in our case. I'm hoping it does in yours, but it's, you know, not easy.
Well, and as we're talking about that, one of the next questions on the list that we have is around women in leadership, particularly in technology spaces. So could you talk about the official question is, why is it important to have women in leadership? But could you also talk about that retention problem that you're seeing where, you know, folks will come in, women will come into the technology space and leave?
Okay, I'm holding. You were looking at me, so I'm going to pretend I'm going to need you want to answer. I mean, I think the question, why should we have women in leadership roles, I can't even answer that because it's very obvious to me. Mm-hmm. It goes back to the, well, of course you should. But in the end, I think, you know, it kind of reflects on the, I mean, if a person entering the field looks up and sees nothing but men up there, and then that creates a culture and permeates down and, you know, creates, you know, some level of hostility or, you know, makes them feel unwelcome, well, that's obvious. I don't know how much of that would change if we had an equal leadership ratio. It's hard to tell. I mean, I see in most places I worked at, surprisingly, I've seen lots of much more female leadership than female junior staff. But it could be because of the places I worked at. I mean, before I was in the College of Liberal Arts here, we had a lot more female leadership than we did elsewhere. So I don't know. I don't really have an answer. But I think the most important thing about the participation going down that we need to pay attention to is look at climate. Look at how we are doing inclusion, because we could be doing well at hiring up front, because that's somewhat easier. Mm-hmm. You can do all sorts of things to improve your hiring, and those are really important things. But then paying attention to how people are behaving, how teams are interacting with each other, and how you are, you know, not letting certain things happen, that's really what I think we should be paying attention to. It's not done when you have checked the box in your, you know, incoming, you know, hiring proportions. Yeah.
So I wonder to what extent there's a gap of interest at the same time, more specific to women in technology. I imagine, I'm not familiar with it, you probably can speak about it, but I imagine that college admissions is as gender neutral as you can imagine, right? I mean, if you have the money, you have a certain interest, whatever the bars are that you need to pass in order to get admitted to a college, you basically get in. It's not the same in the workforce. You need to go through an interview, at least a process that there might be a little more bias. So in women in technology, you find that when you get into an engineering class, you have a lot more men than women, regardless of what the root cause is, there's just less interest. When you get into leadership, I had a suspicion that there wasn't a gap. I did a little bit also, a little bit, like you did, Stephen, a little bit of questioning with the people that I'm working with, particularly with the women, and I was asking, is there a gap in interest in leadership? And there was something that was a surprise, and I almost want to ask the women in the audience here, which is what was said to me during those is like women have a better appreciation for a work-life balance. So I would like to ask the women in the audience, which is, do you feel that you have a greater appreciation for work-life balance than your male counterparts? And raise your hands if you do. Okay, so it's fairly small. Okay, that surprised me, and I'm not sure that it was. That was the case. I have a better appreciation for work-life balance than I think the average, but that's because I come from Spain. It's a culture that has a much better appreciation for work-life balance. But that could force, I mean, whatever the reasons are, that could actually cause a better appreciation. There's whether or not it's true.
I just want to interrupt so that the audience can hear. So what one of our audience members said is one of the major issues there is with children. That's one of the things that makes it asymmetrical.
Yeah, but whether or not it's true, there's a conception that in the higher that you go in leadership, you will actually put a lot more hours into work, and maybe you're not working more hours, but you're thinking about work more often, and then that affects your ability to be at home or to be away from work, right? So if you have a concern about that appreciation of, you know, work-life balance, I can see how you might have a disinterest in a position of leadership.
Yeah, sure.
go for it.
What I'd like to do is kind of speak to the problem specifically. You know, at one point we were trying very actively in one of the labs I was in to recruit a new candidate, a young female candidate that was looking at joining a laboratory. And as we were bringing her through, she chose not to join our laboratory, which you always sit there and you kind of, okay, well, I wonder why they picked another lab, because our lab's clearly one of the better labs, and that's not my lab, this lab I'm in. But afterwards, you know, I told this person, I had lunch with her another time because we were in a faculty, and so we meet together with other grad students. And I did ask her, I said, so why did you choose to join this other lab when our lab's, you know, clearly got a little bit more recognition, potentially there's some options. And I told her, you know, be blunt, I don't care, you're not going to offend me by it. And her comment was, well, I didn't want to work for a man. I wanted to work for a female faculty. Mm-hmm. And you know, I dug into that a little deeper, but I do think that when you have a faculty pool, there are certain women that don't want to work for a man necessarily. And that's a major hindrance. I think that's a major problem for us. I think that we do potentially, I'm not frighten away certain candidates, but I think that when you have that option, there's a huge benefit to that.
Cindy, you have a phone?
Apologize.
Do we really have to repeat it all?
Yes.
I just said that traditionally women are expected to do a lot of the housework too when they get home, so we're forced to create a work-life balance in order to get our other stuff done after we work our 8 or 10 hour days in the office. So that's why. I think that's one of the reasons why.
Right. And part of the prep for this panel, you know, sort of jumping all the way around in our list. But there was research that showed that women were more penalized when they took, you know, family leave or things like that, and for doing the things that society says that women should do more, like have to take care of the home as well as work. So a lot of you are in leadership roles, managing roles, things like that. How do you help to make sure that women aren't unduly penalized in their career, you know, to make sure that they aren't seen as less promotable or less rewardable because of work-life balance issues and things like that?
Well, I don't, in my opinion, it's not necessarily the problem of a single gender. I think the workplace is evolving such that we all need more flexibility, a little more work-life balance, and technology is allowing us to do that. I mean, the younger generations, from what I'm reading, are expecting that. So I think we're in a situation where, you know, just the definition of the traditional workplace might be evolving in a way that I think is positive for things like work-life balance. You know, we're also in a situation sort of economically that a two-income household is becoming sort of the standard in order to maintain a middle-class state of living. And I think if that's going to be the case, then the people who are creating that economic situation need to help us figure out, you know, how we can put policies in place that support that. It isn't necessarily a workplace-to-workplace solution. I think it needs to be even broader than that.
I'll go. Last week I heard a story from somebody, a female who was in a leadership role somewhere, and she talked about a previous job where she asked to take off early for a couple days a week to go pick her kids up from daycare. And her boss, this was a tech startup, said, well, I have hobbies too. And, you know, if that's your workplace approach, then nothing is going to work. And because that's, you know, I think it kind of flipping it around, the what Vicky mentioned about the expectation that you, as the woman, you have to do the housework, you have to take care of the kids and all that. If the implication is that the man doesn't do that stuff because he's working, because, you know, he works 80 hours a week, and when he comes home, he can't do anything. If work-life balance works in for both genders, if we can set the expectation that no, neither gender has to work for 60, 80 hours a week and can't do anything else, then maybe that can be fixed at home too, and then women can step up. If that's one of the reasons they feel they can't, then it can be balanced in a better way. So I think that works, and when I, you know, working here, like I said at the beginning, it's sometimes hard to attract talent. And what I like playing up is to say, hey, you know, you can have work-life balance here. You don't have to work 80 hours a week. You don't have to work weekends. And I like the kind of person that attracts. That then hopefully promotes a work-life balance at home for people of both genders, and they can have a, you know, hopefully better life. But I can't say you get stock options, you get bonuses, you get all this stuff, and, you know, so you have to play to your strengths, right? And I think that's one of our strengths, and I'd like to see more workplaces doing that rather than creating this, you know, treadmill or whatever we want to call it, that just seeks to get people who are alphas who will just want to work 100 hours just to get ahead.
And Brett, I'm curious as to your perspective, particularly from the academic world where, you know, the cliche being publish or perish, and there's sort of this churn. How do you see that playing in with work-life balance and families?
I think that from what I've seen, even though we say that we don't penalize when somebody takes a year and extends their tenure clock to potentially have a child, I think while we say we do that, I don't think we actually do that. I think that to a certain degree it's changing, there's a shift, but you know, that piece of it is still something that hinders, and you do, you have to have people sitting and recognizing as you're reviewing things, oh yeah, this person had a child in the middle of this, or even if the husband didn't have the child, but they had the child together, it, you know, having a baby at home does hinder, I think, as far as what you can get done in a day. I definitely, I mean, I love kids. I love babies. So when my wife had babies in the home, I was home and playing with babies at night. I didn't necessarily want to sit and read papers and things like that. And so I do see that. I think the other piece of it, of the different types of sexism that I've seen in the workplace, I've been thinking about this quite a bit as getting prepared as well, kind of speaks to what we're talking about, which is kind of a cultural sexism, right? And I would say that, I mean, a lot of my own experiences of things where I've seen that has not necessarily even been coming from the people in the management. I mean, I've had students who exhibit a cultural sexism that I've tried to challenge at times, where I've had somebody, you know, I've had a student at one point sit and tell me, oh yeah, you know, I have plans to eventually go on to medical school and become a heart surgeon someday, mm-hmm. and as long as my husband's okay with that. Mm-hmm. And I said, are you seeing somebody right now? Are you dating? No, not yet. That was a really hard one for me to swallow, because I'm like, you're basically changing your whole philosophy of what you're willing to do, commit to, based on somebody that doesn't even exist yet in your life. And so That one was really tough for me to deal with, just mm-hmm. because, yeah, and I did challenge without trying to overstep my bounds that ideal, but that's not something that I can change, because that's something that's inherently internal to the culture, and that was, again, that was part of where I grew up at, part of the culture that I was surrounded with.
Yeah. I think that in terms of flexible schedules, I think that we are living in a changing world, and it's fairly commonplace to hear a male coworker that says, I need to leave at 4 because I need to pick up my child. And that's very, very common, and I think it's becoming a little bit less of an issue. Lack of presence, whether it is, and it's not specific to gender, but whether it's you're working from home or you're taking some time off, takes you away from, well, presence. And that has... Partly, it's probably penalized unfairly, but I mean, if you're working from home, you might even be working more hours, but not being seen has an impact. And if you're thinking of the next person that you're gonna promote, or there's an opportunity, or there's a question, or there's something like that, it's much more difficult to remember somebody. I mean, think of just simply a conference call in which you have somebody on the phone and everybody else in the room. even with perfect audio connection, you're going to have, probably your questions are going to come up much more often, you know, on an even basis to the people that you're seeing. So if you have a need to take 3 months off, whether because you are going to Thailand for a trip or because you're having a baby or because of any of the situations, you will probably see an effect of penalizing, right, you know, and not getting as many opportunities.
Right. And, you know, to sort of pick off that, you know, we have a lot of managers and in the audience as well as in our online audience. So if for the male managers there, what do you recommend as like a concrete practical step? How do the leaders and the managers in technology space make it so that when they have those discussions about promotion and pay raises and things like that, what would you tell the managers in the room that they should do to mitigate some of this sort of conference call effect and some of the other cultural sexism and the things that you see that will make this an unequal situation?
But I would say in that case, he's going back to your earlier comment, that is turning back into being a meritocracy. Hire based on talent, promote based on talent, on value, sort of like be blind to diversity in a way that, you know, be completely focused on what is it that you need in order to advance the business or your college or your institution in any way, and then search for the talent. And with that, diversity should come.
I would say it's important to also stay focused on the results and don't mistake visibility for commitment. And we don't have a maximum flexibility schedule by any stretch, but we think that flexibility is required according to the position and according to you know, the person who's in the position and the commitment that they've shown. I think a certain level of flexibility is just good business, because humans are complicated creatures and we can't assume that they're going to check their discontent at the door when they enter the office. So if there are things that need to be worked out, whether they be in the workplace or outside the workplace, I would rather have somebody, you know, be part of the solution with them to sort of work out a situation, whether it's a leave or, you know, some sort of modified schedule, in order to solve those problems where they're happening so that we can all sort of be productive and move forward together.
Hi, I'm really bad with names, but the third one from the right. sorry. I have a question for you. To your point on blind diversity in hiring and promotion, I'm not saying this is the way it should be, but I just wonder if maybe we need to not be blind, kind of like affirmative action, like the difference between equality and equity. Like, we need equity before we can have equality. So just wanted to throw that out there.
That's a very good point, and I can actually talk both ways. I'm concerned about it, but I was thinking specifically about affirmative action when I was talking about that, which is, what is the right thing to do? Should I completely be blind and trust that things will go forward, and that over time I will very quickly, if everybody's truly blind, I will get diversity, but the reality is not such, right? So at that point is when do I need to tilt slightly in a direction that will start creating that equality, so then diversity will come along. It's a very difficult question, and I think that there's whatever answer you fall into is right and is wrong.
And
so I have an example about that, and I think it's really illuminating to me. At least it was to me. People don't show up to work. My hope is that men or whatever the dominant class doesn't show up to work hoping to oppress people. Most of us show up, just do what we are doing, and we have cultural biases, implicit biases, all of those kind of come together to create the 13% female representation that I'm experiencing right now. It just happens. I read this case study from Montana State University recently. They got an NSF grant to improve hiring in the academic track, and they had a computer science department that was 0% female, and they tried for years to hire better, and they made offers to female candidates who just didn't show up, and they were kind of, you know, despondent about it, and then they started to train their hiring committees for implicit bias, for diversity, and but not the HR people, not the leads, just the entire search committees got training. And they, for the last 4 years, they hit 50% in their new hires. And they swear, I mean, the people who were talking in the study were talking about, they didn't do anything different. They just started working differently because they didn't realize what they were doing before. So I think even without trying to set up quotas, trying to do things, just showing people what they've been doing wrong without realizing it, again, this could be naive and overly optimistic, is really, really helpful. And in this case, I want to bring up our HR department in our department. It's really helpful for them to set up ways for us to do things better. Mm-hmm. Set up ways for us to evaluate candidates in a different way, talk about things in a different way. It happens a lot easier that way, without anybody and without people having to reprogram themselves, without even realizing it. So I think creating the process, the processes, the environment where these are easier, you don't even need to tell people that they are doing something wrong. You just need to show them, here are the ways you might be doing something wrong, here are the ways you need to pay attention, and things can happen much better that way.
Yeah, and it does sound like one of the things you're saying is that the same tactics that got us to where we are today aren't the tactics that are going to get us out of, get us where we need to be tomorrow, and we do need to be deliberate and look at some creative and different ways of doing things. I know that, Brett, one of the things you had mentioned in an earlier thing was potentially even looking at the factors that may be gender specific as your talks, saying, hey, this family, when you're doing promotion, tenure, things like that, saying this particular woman on staff did have a baby this year and that may have affected their output. Do you think that's one thing you would recommend for folks who are doing promotion and tenure?
Well, I think on paper we say we already do it. I kind of want to actually take a step back to what we were talking about in Montana State. I always try to look at other people's perspective. I kind of think that's one of the qualities I do. I try to step out of my own bias. I try to step into somebody else's shoes. I imagine a female faculty going and looking at a department that doesn't have a single other female faculty in it as being something that I'm not in their person's shoes necessarily, but I would sit there and go, yeah, I might go to Berkeley where it's a little bit more diverse, right? Where I've got a little bit better chance. And so I'm just saying, I can see those things too. I don't know how you necessarily overcome it. We have very good training. I mean, I've gone through now several searches, and they do sit down and they do talk, and they do, before you ever even start looking at candidates, try to get you again in that frame of mind to do that. And even during the promotion piece, and we have a faculty member right now who's out on maternity leave, but I have seen it in place, even where people are trying to do it. And I still think that there's still a lot of people in the room that are sitting there just going, well, there was a couple of years where there was productivity. And you have to continually remind people, well, those couple of years, that person had a child, And even when your wife had a child, you had issues with getting into work on time. There were days you showed up and you looked pretty beat up. And so, yeah, that's the piece I would sit there and say. And I do have some male faculty friends who have had children recently, and I can see the difference in their output just from that. And I understand it again because I'm not the traditional, at least from my parents' generation, mm-hmm. where my father never was out in the waiting room. He wasn't in the birth. He never saw any of his children born. Right. He came home and had a expectation of dinner being on the table and that. And so again, there was some cultural sexism that comes out of that. And I'm a child of the 80s. If you look at the culture I was raised in, and I do go back. I mean, I rewatched MASH recently. Oh my gosh, the sexism that I never recognized, but going again and taking it through a different lens is quite amazing. And it was actually quite shocking to me to sit and try to watch some of those things. So in some ways I see progress. In other ways, we're still have a lot of room to grow.
All right. So I want to go through one round of questions, and then we're going to go into a audience Q&A section, and we'll have a lot more time to talk during that as well. But I want to, sort of going down the line, ask this question. If an organization, whether at the university, whether outside the university, whether it's academic department or whatever, if an organization's leadership was serious, or they said they're serious about gender diversity, what do you think is the practical step that that organization's leadership, or maybe some of the staff below leadership, but what would you think is a key thing that they would want to do? What would be your recommendation? And we can start at this end and work over there.
Well, I think if the organization is here at the university, you might start by looking at some of the resources that are available on campus and within the system. I learned recently that our HR department is about to launch a series of diversity and inclusion seminars for our employees that are sponsored by the EOAA office here on campus. Some of you may be familiar with that. We hired a staff member specifically to keep an eye on these issues and to help us develop a culture around them. And she's undergone the full training session. I think it's 30 some hours to get her certification. So yeah, I really commend our organization at the foundation for sort of stepping up and putting this on all of our radar screens. So we look forward to taking advantage of those.
I'm going to say the exact same things. I think paying attention is. Paying attention is the important thing. Look at your numbers. Look at your behavior. Look at what people are doing. I love the MASH example. You didn't notice that at the time. It was just the way things were. Look at the way things are right now, and try to tease those out without the help of 20 plus years of perspective. Maybe it's difficult, but you can still do it. And then using resources that are available, especially here. My experience is the same. There is a lot of stuff our HR department does, our equity and diversity people do, and making use of those is useful. But you need to start with, what are we doing wrong? Mm-hmm. What is going wrong here that is not obvious? Okay. Just because you're productive doesn't mean that your department is doing well.
So I would say, first thing, I think you should hide the names on a resume. They provide zero value when you receive them, and they point to gender and cultural origin. And there's nothing on a name that makes a person more qualified. That will make it blind, which might be a little bit against that one. But I will let HR worry about the ratios that are being hired or not. As a hiring manager, I will look at basically qualification. Second one is that you should encourage women to apply to positions. I think that from a study from McKinsey, they do it every year, but they just lean in on McKinsey about women in the workplace. It talks about that. A man and a woman, both equally qualified, the man is more likely to apply for a position that he feels that he's not entirely qualified than a woman. I think that what you need to do is encourage women to apply for a position. Nobody's fully qualified for a position when they applied for it. I think that that's part of the game, right? You need to grow into that position. Mm-hmm. So that would be the second one. And I had another one in which make the case for diversity. That is not gender, not specific to race, not specific. Basically, diversity brings different points of view, different cultural backgrounds, different ideas, different experiences. All of those things have the potential to improve an organization.
I would say two things. One is, I've visited a lot of upstart biotech companies, and you go into some of these workplaces, and they are so different than what I would expect. You have video gaming rooms. You have daycare on the same floor. I just imagine being able to take your kids and drop them off down the hallway at a room you could walk in and check in on them at any time, be able to go have lunch with your kids, do that so you can still have that and see that. I don't know how you necessarily change that. I don't know how you put that into place here. But when you see things like that and you go, that right there could really increase inclusion. And so I'd love to see things like that kind of taking place. And now I just forgot my second one. So I have to come back to it.
That's all right. And I'm sure we'll have some good questions that will bring this out. So if you have a question, raise your hand and we'll grab this microphone in 3 seconds and we will bring it to you. So go ahead.
So I think often the comment of, well, there's not a lot of women in the applicant pool is fairly common. So I guess my question to you guys is, and I don't think the problem is really that there aren't women that have qualifications. So what do you see as ways to change how you reach out to get women to apply for jobs, or how do you assist them in that process for whatever barriers that they have?
I will say two things. One, mentor, or learn to recognize talent, to seek it and look for it, and then mentor people. People grow into talents that become a role model to people. You know, as you advance in your career, you learn things. Reach out to people of any gender and any race background, but basically mentor them into roles and then encourage them to seek opportunities.
This is a very simple one, but it's very, very effective. Look at the way you're writing your job descriptions. One of us already mentioned that men will apply to any job, regardless of whether they're qualified. Women will make sure that they satisfy 100% of the criteria. If you write very long, very detailed job descriptions, you're already doing it. That's the instinct we have. We want to have experience in everything. We want to lay down every detail, and that filters people out. And if you do that better, you get a bigger pool. You'll have to work harder to filter people out and all that, but you'll get a bigger pool, and that's going to be more diverse.
Yeah, I think networking can play a role here. As leaders, we're all out there promoting our organizations and attracting the best talent for the jobs that we have available. And hopefully, just by virtue of being on this panel, our organizations are getting something of a reputation. So I think we shouldn't forget about those.
So we talk a lot about hiring and about getting women into pipeline for tech. AAUW did a study that showed that once women are in those tech-related careers, they are more likely than almost any other profession to drop out. That includes, you know, a lot of high-stress ones like law, like medicine. What do we do once we get those women into the roles to retain them in our organizations or places like the U?
Okay, I'll take it, I guess. like I said before, I think that's one of the bigger problems that we have right now, keeping people once they've started their careers. And I think, I mentioned before, paying attention to what's going on, paying attention to what the team is doing to exclude women or not work well with them, that must be the reason. I can't really think of anything else. High pressure, whatever. There could be other things going on, but I think most of it is what your teams are doing, what your organization is doing, and paying attention to that. I can't really tell you exactly what the facts are about this. I think it's a very complicated problem, but that's where we should start. That's how we can clean our own house, so to say.
I think that you're touching right on it. I think that diversity is not something just at the entry door, but it's actually to retention as well. It's a very difficult question because you're stating the problem without a root cause, right? I don't know why women would leave certain fields and the retention might be a little bit more difficult. Knowing the problem allows you to start tackling. I think what you need to do is probably communication. So understand what is the reason why people are leaving and that might be too late. What are the reasons why people are unhappy about our position, and try to catch it before it happens?
And I just want to highlight something that I think lots of people brought up in there, is the importance of listening. The idea that we can go ahead with these blinders and not see the problem, but like Kamal said, the first thing is paying attention to the numbers, paying attention to the experiences of women in our space, and like Dave was saying, figuring out what that root cause is, figuring out what is going on in our particular space that's kicking people out.
I was going to pipe in real quick. I would say the other thing I would really look at as far as retention is honesty. I think we have a real lack of honesty. I did have a person who worked for me when I was in industry at one point who I really appreciated, of all my employees, probably the most beneficial for me as far as supporting me as I was starting off as a young supervisor, and she was having a child and she was going to go on maternity leave, and she was also in a kind of an odd position because she was one of the few people in my laboratory that did not have a technical degree. She'd not gone to college. And so she'd kind of been promoted from within to a certain degree, and people always kind of looked out for her. And she was very concerned when she was leaving to go out on that she was going to come back and her position might be gone. And I had to really reassure her. I'm like, you know, look, I don't know if I say it enough, but I do appreciate the fact that I have you working for me, because it makes my day a lot better to have somebody that supports me. And so, you know, you're definitely coming back to a job, and it's going to be protected. And when she did come back to a job, she actually came back to another female counterpart to work with as well. So there were things that we were doing to make that change. But letting people know that they're appreciated in that regards was very important to me. And even beyond that, when I left the organization, I took steps to make sure that my manager knew to kind of watch out for this person, to take care of him, because again, there was a big benefit to having that person in there. And so, but a lot of that, you know, if I hadn't been a lot more honest about that in that situation, I don't know. You know, we did have some times where we would have people go out on maternity leave and they wouldn't come back. They would go home and they had a situation. They're like, yeah, maybe I don't want to come back. Maybe I want to. And it was nice to have that retention. So.
Hello, thank you very much. Patricia Isaac, I am a diversity and inclusion recruiter here at the university, and I sit in Central HR. So much of what you're saying, you're spot on. One thing I haven't heard you mention, it's about the pool. Harvard Business Review just had a recent study, and what they found is that when you have a pool and you bring one diverse candidate into the pool, the search committee feels great because they have a diverse pool. But in essence, it does absolutely nothing. Nothing to have one individual in your pool of three or four or five or whatever that number is. The study showed that it wasn't until you had two diverse individuals that a bit of significance, and I can't remember the exact number, so I won't quote it, but it began to show a difference. But it wasn't until you reached a 50% pool that then a significant difference showed, and then you truly increased the chance of diversity. So until we commit to making that pool 50% pool, we're just having a nice conversation. Everything you have said is spot on. You have to look at that posting. That posting has to speak to that diverse individual in a way that no other posting does. If I need a job, I'm going to apply to whatever is out there. But I'm going to put those jobs in a certain order because I have energy, and I'm going to put my most energy into that job that speaks to me, the diverse candidate. So if your job is the one that's speaking to me, I'm going to apply to your job first. And I will apply to all the others. And you're absolutely right. Men, McKinsey's report is absolutely spot on. Men will apply to everything. Women will not. And that's because culturally, that's how we have been conditioned. We want to be sure because everything has to be perfect for us, just as for all diverse candidates. So I commend the work you're doing. I really can see that you're trying. And OED has just, we partnered with them, and we have a new search committee bias video, a whole training that's out there. So there's one for faculty and one for staff as well. And I implore you to search it out. We have wonderful resources here, and there are wonderful resources out there. The world is a different world. We have to embrace it. So thank you very much, and I just love the work I do here, and I do believe that we are making the change with panels such as yours. So thank you.
So I'd like to.
Can I piggyback on that? I love what Steve said about policy. I don't need that.
I know.
You do for the other.
How can we feed the pipeline of generations coming up with putting dollars towards STEM programs that encourage girls to go into the program? Because I know for a fact my own child was in a STEM program at the U that got cut because there was just no funding. So it's all about feeding that pipeline to get more applicants for you.
Right. I think that you're spot on the piggyback. If I can add something here, I would love to have, when I have an opening, and I've had in 20 years, I've had, I don't know, about 15, 20 openings. I don't have enough candidates, period. I've had openings for 6 months in which I had zero candidates that were qualified. When I have a number, when I have an opening that maybe is a little bit easier to fill in and you get a number of resumes, I may get 1, 2, 3 women applying out of 20, 30 applications that make it my way through HR, and that's with a filter that's already trying to tilt it towards diversity. The candidates are just not there. So is it a lack of interest? Most of the candidates, surprisingly, most of the candidates that you find are female usually come from India, because there's a culture in which there's a lot more women that are in technology. So I would love to have a 50-50 option.
It's not a question of not interest, or it is about, at my dinner table from immigrant parents, a mother who never went to school, when we sat around and we talked about what do you want to do when you grow up, these were the choices: a doctor, a lawyer, or an engineer. Researcher wasn't even on there. A teacher was, but I mean, it's just these conversations aren't the ones that are there. If we're serious, we need to reach out to these communities at a much younger age. Your department should be at the local grammar schools, having little fairs and bringing the families in, so that when these children grow up, they want to be what you're looking for. And we don't do that. So, you know, it's just about creating that awareness. So it is, and I'll be honest with you, we have the population, but that population, our diverse community, has choices. We are coming on a little bit late to the game. So there are corporations and universities that are doing outstanding jobs, and I hate to say a little bit better than ours. We're going to catch up, though. We will. The University of Minnesota can get there. We just have to be as committed as we are when we really mean things. So it can happen.
Thank you very much. We have a number of other questions, but I also want to point out that with this being a Male Allies panel, one of the things that we're hoping to bring out, and for the men in the audience and the men who are watching online, all these things that we're talking about, you know, getting into the pipeline early, figuring out, being committed to, if not attaining, getting ever closer to that 50%, as well as those retention things, these are things that are in a large part our responsibility. And so I'm hoping that everyone who's listening and in this room, particularly those of us who are male and identify as male, don't just see this as somebody else's problem, but something that we should take on ourselves. So I know we have a couple of hands up, so let's go to the next question.
I wanted to address the pipeline issue as well. Having been in that pipeline myself 46 years ago, and being absolutely discouraged from continuing in that part of the tech, I come back to it afterwards. But my daughter, 35 years later, ran into the exact same thing when she entered this university with that type of implicit bias in how she was treated in classrooms. So a lot of the things that we've encountered require the, shall we say, the dominant culture to actively undermine that implicit bias in their colleagues, or to counter it by saying, you know, this is something that we do. So thinking of that, we've talked about going to these seminars about bias and inclusivity and things like that. But have we actually measured whether or not we have corrected the practice? Because I'm not sure we have.
I respond to that in a general sense. I think there's an awareness in my department right now that we have this issue, and what we've been trying to do is, you got to get away from surveys, and you've got to get people into a room where you can have an honest discussion, and that's what it's got to kind of come down to. And we have a tremendous opportunity because we have a very dominant male faculty, we have a very equal student body, and so you know, what I've been kind of pushing in my own department is get away from these surveys, because you don't get the right answers on the surveys. You're not hearing the problems on the surveys. Just find several faculty members or bring in a third party to do interviews with your students at the end of it and find this out. Because I do see, I see equally, we have certain dominant people on our faculty that potentially, and it's been in every faculty, it's not just my department, I'm not going to pick on my department, but you do have dominant personalities that I think can really destroy a student. I felt this with my own child at one point, where one of his science teachers really destroyed his love for science one year, and that was really heartbreaking to me to watch that. I'd hate to see that for for young girls as well, but I think it's more of a problem for young girls.
I want to take a slight twist on the question as well. How do you, so, you know, we talked about basically with the other men and the other folks in the department, how do we move people from being passive to being active about this, from being just letting it go and to becoming allies? What has been your experiences with that?
To that answer, and I think that you're spot on when you're talking about not looking at surveys. I think it was Henry Ford that said, whether you think that you can or you can't, you're right. And you cannot become a victim to statistics. That is, regardless of what statistics said, look at your specific opportunity and ignore what you know. If you have an 80% chance of this position going to a male candidate instead of female, well, it doesn't matter. At the end, 20% of the women will get that position, and you know, statistics have proven that a recent election went entirely, you know, in a different direction than was expected. So what I'm trying to say with that thing is in order to, you can worry about the problem in the aggregate when you look at the statistics, but for each position, for each person that you are mentoring, for each individual circumstance, you need to ignore that aggregate problem and basically tackle it individually.
So I have an MFA degree and don't do concrete very well. But I thought we'd be remiss if we didn't sort of acknowledge the volume of the conversation around these issues based on what happened last Saturday in our country, on our planet. I feel like the conversation is building, and you know, we should all feel very optimistic about that. And now it's sort of on all of us to keep it at the front of our individual consciousnesses. So hopefully, you know, we can take that forward, and just the more these topics arise in the national and international conversations, you know, they will trickle down to the concrete level, and we can all take very definitive action.
So I'm actually going to jump in here.
Can I answer that question?
it actually goes back to the conversations that you guys had with your staff. You mentioned how you talked with the women. I'm wondering if you talked with the men of your group as well and what their perspective was on that issue and that conversation.
So I'll give you an example. It actually works for this one too. When I started my current job about 16, 18 months ago, a staff member of mine, who's actually in this room, I'm not going to name her, came to me out of the blue and told me what a terrible job we're doing at hiring women. And, you know, and she had concrete examples. She had, you know, I mean, not complaints, but it wasn't a very comfortable conversation for me. But it was a great one to have because I was challenged in the right way. I was asked to do something about something that I didn't necessarily pay attention to. I mean, it was the job descriptions and where we were posting things. I mean, again, I like to think that most people don't wake up in the morning to oppress other people. Most people just want to go do their jobs, take care of their families, and you know, they go through their day, and stuff just happens because that's how, you know, we're in a groove that just, you know, goes forward. And stopping to think about that and paying attention is really helpful. So what I did after that was I went and changed the way we were doing job descriptions, and I talked to the man about this, and I talked to other people where we are going to post things, how we are going to look at things. I mean, it's a very small example. It didn't change the world or anything, but it really changed the way I was thinking about things and made me pay more attention. So my advice, so to say, to the audience would be go challenge people. Not in a way, I mean, you don't need to call them names, you don't need to, you know, tell them they are being stupid, but you can just say, have you paid attention to how you are writing your job descriptions? Have you paid attention to what you are, you know, looking for or how you are treating your team members? And I think that's helpful for everybody, and, you know, it's just, we are who we are. We can't improve if we don't get feedback.
I just wanted to say something to that. When you're talking about it's how we write our job descriptions and then who we get in, I think there's also kind of this subconscious bias when you look at female candidates versus male candidates. And I've been on the receiving end of this and as part of a hiring team that has done this, that you look at male candidates for their potential but you look at female candidates for their experience. So if you don't have the experience, how do you get the experience if no one's going to give you the experience? But if you're looking at male candidates because, you know, that guy will really, like, you know, make a difference here, but you're not looking at female candidates in the same way, that's a real problem. So
I actually wanted to pipe in really quickly, because you've said it a couple times, so I don't want to harp on you about it, but you say that you believe that most people don't necessarily wake up in the morning saying, I'm going to impress people. I think there are some people out there that do. I don't think they know they're doing it, but I think that they wake up. I think it's a self-preservation thing. I think it's maintaining the status quo. And by doing that, you're waking up and you're saying, I'm going to get out there and impress some people today. And so I think having those conversations, and typically the people that are probably doing that are the hardest people to have those conversations with, because it has become a point where it's a defense. It's something you really are protecting. And so I think that's an issue, but I did want to kind of bring something to that, because I have the same thing. I'd like to say that I believe that most people will do good things, but I think that you have to be willing to acknowledge that there are some people that undermine, and they really are out there, and it's something that people have to deal with.
There's a reason I say most people.
Yes.
And I think that's kind of going back to what Richard asked us at the beginning of these questions. What can leadership do? This is one of those things. That's part of paying attention to me. If you see somebody who goes out of their way to be sexist, to be racist, to be whatever it is, if you can't tell that, then it's your responsibility as a leader to say, we're not going to put up with this. You're done here. And move on. But again, for many, many people, this is just something that they need to be reminded of, not just once, not just twice, but regularly. And that's why I love having an HR department that actually does this for us. To your point about screening women based on their experience and men on their potential, that's why Diego mentioned it, remove the names. It's harder, it's kind of, you know, drudgery to do that because you need to keep track of things in a different way, but I know it helps, and it's just not women. If you can tell from somebody's name that they are, you know, black, well, you know, that has an impact too. Those are very easy things to do, but you have to continue doing them. You can't just say, we did it once, it worked, yay, for us, and you keep doing it.
I'd like to talk a little bit about retention and rewarding. It would be great if we could have this meritocracy where you're just rewarded for doing a good job. But how we evaluate a good job is also very culturally entrenched. I've worked in many environments where men feel very comfortable and emboldened to step up and grab the bull by the horns, as it were, where maybe their solution was not the best solution, but they showed the initiative, and they're rewarded that way. And I think it's also pretty telling that our example of meritocracy was, you know, the guys working in the garage and forsaking everything else, maybe even their children, to achieve this great technical feat. So.
The only thing that I would say is that you hit the nail in the head in terms of measuring performance. It's difficult even when gender is not an issue, right? You have two people that do different jobs but within the same organization, and you need to measure performance. It makes it very difficult. I work at Medtronic. I think it's a fantastic company, but our HR group likes to change at most every 2 years. They like to change how you measure performance, and is just trying to chase that one way or another. It is not easy as a manager, it's not easy as an employee, it's not easy in any possible way. I'm still in favor of a meritocracy. You're looking for results at the end. So I don't even care how you did it, as long as you don't leave any bodies behind, but you need to achieve some results. And if you do it, I don't care what your gender is, you know, I want to coach you to stay within the organization and to grow within it.
One more?
Okay, then I'm going to make a quick statement. We talked about kind of going back into Laura's statement that she made. You talked about not being able to retain your talent, and I would challenge you that women normally make less than men, and if they are going to be leaving, go to bat for them.
So we've got
one more.
Oh.
Well, since we're short on time, I'll just make a statement rather than a question, so we don't take too much time. Have you thought about when it regarding retention, what you can do internally with mentorship for women within your company?
So last one. So you did mention that if you're a leader and you see, you know, behavior that's adverse to gender diversity, that you should address it. How do you address that if you're not a leader? Like, if I see something, how do I approach that?
So I did experience this during my time in industry, where I had a fellow person I worked with who was, at the time, was in position and stature in the company, was below me, but then moved above me and became a supervisor. And it's very unique because she then got a boss who was a little bit sexist, very much sexist, and really was trying to hold her down from her position and keep her out of meetings and things. And I had the unique position where I got moved out of that department and moved into a different position where I had the ear of kind of the, not the company head, but the manager for our plant. And I would sit in on those meetings sometimes where I would see it, and I would point out, you basically have an invaluable resource who knows what they're talking about, and you're spewing things that you have no idea what you're talking about in these meetings. I don't know why you're not bringing her in on these things. The thing I would say is, prior to that, I was in the position where if I watched it, I wasn't going to stand up because I also had to take care of my own family, look out for my own benefits. So I think there is, once you get in those positions, you do have to call those things out. And so I don't know how necessarily you do it. If you have a good HR department, I'd like to think that the HR department can stand in. We had a very strong HR department within our company at that time. And so the HR was aware of some of the situations that were going on. But I do think it's difficult, and I do think there's a lot of times where you're afraid for your own job stability to potentially jump in on some of those things when you see that.
Yeah. One of the things I'm going to point out as we sort of wrap this up is that we mentioned a ton of resources, the things that are available from the HR departments here at the university and very likely in your HR departments as well. We also mentioned a ton of resources from Equity and Diversity's website, diversity.umn.edu, that's available both to folks who are internal to the university as well as to folks who are external there as well. Obviously, we don't have enough time for the depth that this conversation deserves. So while we are going to sort of close up and wrap up this event, and I'll hand back to Susan after this, I encourage you to have more of these conversations. Have more of those conversations today if you have some time. I think there's still some coffee and pastries there. You know, corner some of the panelists, ask them the question that I didn't give you time to ask. Corner me and ask me the question. I'm okay with that too. But truly, you know, the thing that, if people were skeptical, one of the things I do want to highlight is notice the amount and the depth and the passion of the questions and comments and statements that we received from the audience. This is a big deal, and this is something that we as a university community, we as technologists, we as human beings who are in theory interested in good in the world should pay attention to. And I thank you for coming and paying attention to this and paying attention to us as we're doing. And let's give a round of applause for our panelists who have shared their experience.
Thank you so much, Richard. Thank you so much to all of you panelists. We really appreciate you coming and taking the time today to start this discussion. Although I know that this discussion has been going on here at the university and elsewhere for a while, for a long time in some cases, but still to kind of kick off within this community. Thank you, audience members, for bringing your questions, for being participative. And I hope that you feel empowered to bring this discussion going forward. I want to mention one thing that was mentioned was, you know, this was a small thing that I did and it may not change the world. I think it is the small things that we do that do build up to change the world. So conversations like this, I think, are just a good starting part to make those small changes that will continue to change things. Couple closing things, that is that we will have a happy hour next Thursday, next week, February 2nd, at the Town Hall Brewery from 4 to 6 p.m., and we may have one or two panelists join us there, so that should be a fun event. Things that that can keep you informed of what we're doing moving forward, again, is the WIT website, wit.umn.edu, so if you're not on the mailing list yet, please do go there, and if you didn't catch that when I said it right now, just corner one of us committee members afterwards and get that information. Again, thank you all for being here. We do have this room until 11, so do feel free to stick around for conversation and more coffee. Thanks again. Thank you, panelists.